God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. Won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Shout out your praise. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his be seated.
Afterwards, and the kitchen was right behind the baptistry wall here, was right on that side. Well, I'm about halfway through my message, and they start frying chicken. They didn't bring it in from Publix and that kind of, now they were frying chicken back there. And that smell just sort of started coming through here, and you're trying to preach, and you've got fresh fried chicken going on. That's hard to keep an audience, I'm telling you right there. So if you smell it this morning, just hang on, we're gonna get that way. That's going to be right after our service this morning. Don't forget about our block party. It's coming up on April the 1st. That's next weekend. And so make sure that I know that you're signed up. And if you weren't at the meeting the other day, or if you weren't at the meeting, here's going to be the plan. Just show up. We'll have something for you to do. There is plenty to do. And the biggest thing is meeting and greeting and talking to people when we get out there. And so we're going to start trying to set up around 9 o'clock or so. Jeff's going to meet me here. We'll get some tables over there. And we'll be over there trying to get set up. So you come. We're going to have a great morning. That morning. Also keep in mind, we've got on here Baptism Sunday. We're planning on a Baptism Sunday, April 23rd. I've talked to a number of people about baptism, some children who haven't been baptized yet, some adults that haven't been baptized yet. And if you're praying about that, if you're working through that, we're gonna make a special day of that. If you need to be baptized yourself or someone in your family, you come and see me and we'll get that worked out. But we're gonna plan a special day after Easter to celebrate baptism. So keep that in mind. Next week we'll be observing the Lord's Supper. And so as we come to worship together next week, we'll be taking the Lord's Supper together. Look forward to that day as well. So Brother Terry, you come this morning and fill us in on a couple of things and pray for us this morning.
Good morning. It's good to be here. Just a couple of things this morning. Brother Ottaway Fillingham is your ministry deacon this week. If you have any needs, please give him a call. As I always say, if you can't reach him, call any of us. We'd be glad to help you, but do that. And also, we'll be receiving our tithes and offerings down at the altar here in just a few moments. If you're visiting with us today, welcome. We're glad you're here. Glad you're here among us today. You know, here we are. I think this is the last Sunday in March. You know, 4 months into the new year. I don't know about you, but time's flying for me. Hey, don't forget your taxes either. That's a downer, ain't it? And Dr. Stone talking about the chicken frying. Well, we're supposed to have our Old Testament class tonight, but I think we're going to postpone it because after the fish fry, everybody be full of fish, go home. I don't know about getting back. If you do get back, you're going to go to sleep on me. So I need, it's a good lesson, 2 Kings chapter 6. We'll do it. Not next week, but the next one. It's a good lesson, so prepare for that. Go ahead and read up on it. So let's pray together this morning. I know you have a lot on your heart. There's a lot going on in our church and a lot going on in your life. So let's pray this morning. Father, we come to you this morning. Lord, we come thanking you for the opportunity and the ability to come to your house, to gather together to worship you, Lord. And Father, you do see each one of us. You see our hearts. You know what's on our hearts this morning, Lord. Father, just lift up those who are having difficult times right now, Lord, those who may be grieving the loss of a loved one, Lord, I lift them up. Father, I ask for your consolation of them, to them. And Father, I just ask for you to be with those who are having difficult times in other areas and relationships, Lord. Father, you know our heart. You know what's going on in each of our lives. And I just ask that you strengthen and give comfort to those. Father, give comfort to those caretakers, those who are taking care of sick loved ones. Strengthen them. Lord, I've talked to some this week, and I know that's going on in their lives, and I just ask you to strengthen them. Father, I thank you so much for paying attention to the details of the lives of your people, Father. Lord, I just ask you this morning to speak through your word, the message you've given Dr. Stone, that you've given him to deliver to us, Lord. Let us receive it in our heart. Let us listen to your word, Lord. Hear it, but listen. Father, listen and take action to understand. Father, be with him. Give him strength and boldness. Lord, be with us as we witness and testify what you've done for us to others. Give us the strength and boldness. We have events coming up, Lord, that we need to testify what you have done for your people, what you've done for us. Lord, be with Brother Blake this morning as we lift praises to your name. Be with the choir, the musicians. Lord, we just want to praise you today. We want to worship. Lord, we're expectant. Lord, we wish to hear from you today. And Lord, we'll be listening. Be with us as we receive our tithes and offerings. Lord, we just ask you to use them to further your kingdom. Lord, multiply them where they need multiplying. And Father, we give you the glory for it. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
It's hard to believe. I have faith that you will do greater things. It's my time to go, but before I leave, go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. Gotta go now for a little while, but goodbye is not the end. Don't forget the things that I taught you. I've conquered death and I hold the keys. Where I go, you will do greater someday. But there's much to do here before you leave. So go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. I've gotta go now for a little while. But goodbye is not the end. Spirit is tell them about me. I've gotta go for a little while, but goodbye is not the end.
Let's all join together for a couple more songs of praise this morning.
Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only want to hear your voice. Hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we want to know you more and more. We're hanging on every word. Come and speak to us, O Lord. To hear your voice, we're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we want to know you more and more. We're hanging on every word. 'Cause when you speak and when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we and what we seek. When you come in the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what.
this time, children will be dismissed for children's church.
Be seated.
Amen. Let's pray. pray together this morning. Father, we come before you, thanking you, Lord, for this opportunity to just come and lift up our voices to praise you this morning. Father, you are so worthy of the praise that we bring, and Father, we just thank you for filling this place with your Spirit this morning. Father, speak to us. We need your instruction. We need your counsel. And Father, open our hearts that you may speak into our lives today and into the life of this church. So Father, we ask you now for just understanding. We ask you now for you to just move in a way that can only be explained is that God was in this place. So be with us now. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Finishing up this morning in our series, I Am the Church. And have to go back into the book of Acts one more time, and I'm sorry to our ladies, and if they've covered this, they know all about it. If not, I'm just giving you a little bit of taste when you get to Acts 16, talking about our worship and our witness. Do you think about those two things being the same? Our worship and our witness, they're basically tied together. And that's what I want you to see this morning as we look at this one passage in the book of Acts this morning, Acts 16, verse 25. And the Word of God says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Let that verse sink in just a minute. They were praying and singing hymns, and the prisoners were listening to them. As we've gone through this series that we're completing this morning, I Am the Church, I was thinking about the ministries of our church, the things that we do. And I've thought about the congregation and our church family, as we've talked about it being a body, the body of Christ. And I've thought about the responsibility and the opportunity that we face as a church. And as I was thinking about these things over the last couple of months, a question came to my mind, and the question was this: what is it that we long for and pray for as a church family? Now, I know we're praying for a lot of things. We're praying for our new building, and that's a great thing to be praying for. We're praying that the lost would be saved. We're praying that God would use us in big ways. We're praying for, just a little side note, praying for volunteers, and if you're not volunteering already, look into that. We need folks in the nursery, and we need folks with children, and we need folks all over. So pray about that as a member of the body of Christ. But we're praying for a lot of things. But the one thing that I've really prayed for over the past couple of months in particular is that together as a church body, we would become a worshiping and a witnessing community of God's people. A worshiping and a witnessing community of God's people. We want those who look at us to see that our hearts are so touched by the Spirit of God that when we open our mouths, we declare His praise. And to be a people who are so in touch with the Son of God that as we go about our daily routine, it would be customary for us, it would be automatic for us to speak concerning the Lord Jesus Christ to those around us. And that we would be a Spirit-filled church who would be alive, only alive by the power of God. That we'd be a striving church to move forward in our worship and in our witness. And that's the reason I draw your attention this morning to Acts 16, 25. The passage sort of slips into the narrative right here. There's not a lot of information following up to it. It says there in verse 25, at about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. The context for this really emerges in the verses coming around it that Luke gives to us in his explanation. And we have an encounter here that leads up to this worship and leads up to this praise and this witness. We have an encounter of three different individuals that we need to just look quickly at to set the context here. First of all, we have the life of a businesswoman by the name of Lydia. Lydia had been attending the place of worship. She was listening to the Word of God, and by her listening to the Word of God, the Word of God had touched her, the truth of God had touched her, and her life was changed. It was transformed by the power of the gospel. Number two, we read a little further in the opening verses of the section that follows here about on their journey to the place of prayer, they have this encounter with this anonymous slave girl. This girl was possessed by a demon, by a spirit, and this spirit enabled her to tell the future, and her owners used and abused her to make money off of her so she could tell the fortunes of those people who would pay for it. But as Paul and Silas ran across her, she was delivered of that demon, she was delivered of that spirit, and set free. And the third section that we did not read this morning, it follows the course of our reading, is the story of the conversion of the Roman jailer. But what I want you to see clearly here is that all of these individuals, Lydia, the slave girl, the Roman jailer, they're all very different people. They're all different racially, socially, psychologically. They're worlds apart in who they are and what they believe. But I want you to notice one thing. Although they were worlds apart, they were totally different individuals, they were changed by the same powerful Word of God. That's what changed them. And we see that if we're going to be the church, if we're going to be the body of Christ, if we're going to be a worshiping and a witnessing church, we need to take seriously the opportunities and the responsibilities of our day. We're called to reach out to people, whatever their status, whatever their background, whatever their color, whatever their ethnicity is, we're called to reach out to all people. Because the Word of God, the gospel itself, impacts the lives of different people. And we see that in these incidences that are recorded in Scripture this morning. But we know this morning that the Word of God, it doesn't matter your race, creed, or color, the Word of God will change an individual once God touches their hearts. And it's our responsibility to carry that message. Now that leads us to the arrival of Paul and Silas into the picture here. Paul and Silas had exercised the spirit of this slave girl as they went to prayer that day. But they did more than exercise the spirit of this slave girl, because what they did was they banished the source of income for this slave girl's owners. In Acts 16 verse 19 it says, "But when her owners saw that their hope of gain was gone, they seized Paul and Silas, and they dragged them to the marketplace before the rulers." These men were enraged. This girl, who was a money-making machine, had been delivered from this evil spirit, and now she's no longer able to make money for these men. And so they grab up Paul and Silas, and they drag them to the marketplace before the authorities. They took them to the agora, which is, again, the marketplace, but it was this central public square. If you've ever been in a small town, a country town, there's many of them around where I live, where I'm from, they had a town square. There's one place I know I can picture vividly in my mind this morning. It's a place called Russellville, Kentucky, and when you come to the four-way stop, you're downtown, and you have to go right, and then you have to go left, and then you have to... You make that square, around that square right there. Many, many towns are like that. But that's the picture of what we have here. We have this town square. It functioned not only as a marketplace, but as a social center for the day. People would gather there looking for day laborers, and if they needed jobs, they would come there, and people would come, and they would pick up day laborers for the day. The sick were brought there to be healed. The magistrates judged court in these places as well, and so... A plaintiff could drag a defendant into court and ask the judge to pass a verdict right there in the town square. Well, the owner of these slave girls were acting according to the Roman law. They lay their hands on Paul and Silas, and they have their grievances, and they take them to the magistrates. And the accusers open up the proceedings there by declaring in verses 20 and 21, "And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, 'These men are Jews, and they are disturbing our city. They advocate customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to accept or practice.'" So they bring them to the magistrates. But what's so amazing here, what's really laughable here, is how they seek to be so skillful to disguise their main concern. Their main concern was they've lost income. They're not really concerned about anything else, but they can't say that to the magistrates. They have to make a legal case. So they charge Paul and Silas. They say these men are teaching customs which are not lawful for us to accept or observe as Roman citizens. And technically, that was true. They had a technicality here. That was true. The law was that it forbid Roman citizens to practice any foreign religion that hadn't been sanctioned by the state. The problem with that, though, it was rarely enforced. No one ever enforced that law. Yes, it was on the books. You know, it's like some laws on books today. You know, you can't have your horse out past 11 or, you know, whatever. There's all kind of laws still on the books at different places that make totally no sense for our day, but they're still on the books. They rarely enforce this law at all. But the charge that the missionaries were creating confusion, trying to incite a riot, was even more, it was just false. It wasn't true. But what was it that made Paul and Silas, about Paul and Silas that made these men so angry? Again, it was the fact that their profit was gone. They couldn't make any more money off this slave girl. They had dismantled their sources of income. And so because they had been making a killing off of this girl financially, now she's gone. Now these men have to find somebody to pay for it. And so they take them to the magistrates. And again, very skillfully, they lay out the case that these men were teaching false religions. These men were introducing alien religions, if you want to say it that way. They were trying to cause riots. They were saying all of these things. But the fact was, Paul and Silas were seeking to do neither one of these things. The men were telling these stories, trying to drum up the crowd, and that's what they did. They incited a riot. The people that were there listening to this case got all involved in this. They were irate about what they heard. They stirred up the marketplace that day, and the chief magistrates, they failed miserably as judges in this case. They had no investigation into the charge. There was no proper hearing. Paul and Silas had no chance to defend themselves before the magistrates at all. But instead, it says the magistrates here tore off the robes of these men, and they proceeded to have them beaten with rods. Now, we can read that very quickly and say, well, they were beaten with rods. But it's really a lot more intense than you think. I mean, I don't want to be beat with a rod this afternoon. I don't think many of you do as well, but they were beaten with rods. The lectors, the policemen of the day, had what they called rods, but these rods were composed of smaller rods tied together with a whipping effect at the end. And so they would have these rods and they would beat whoever was sentenced to be beaten. We're told in 2 Corinthians that on three different occasions, Paul was beaten with rods. He knew what it was like. Acts 16:23-24 says, when they had inflicted many blows upon them, they threw them into prison, ordering the jailer to keep them safely. Having received this order, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet into stocks. They're thrown into prison. They stand this mock trial. They're beaten with rods. They're bloody. They're worn out. They're in pain. They're hurting. And now they're thrown in prison. The jailer here guards them carefully because he's told to guard them carefully. Places them into the inner cell. He fastens their feet into stocks. And after having received what is this dreadful beating, Luke tells us here in verse 25. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. It's not really a surprise to me that the prisoners would listen to them. I mean, here's these men, they come in bloody, beaten, worn out. They're placed into the cell, and it says they begin to pray and they begin to sing, and the prisoners are listening to them. This was totally different from what the prisoners were used to hearing. Now, you have to put on, as the teachers used to say, your thinking cap just a little bit here. Turn on your imagination a little bit. They're in jail. You can imagine what the normal talk of the jail cell would be with the curses and the expletives going on, the complaining, the whining, the hurt, the pain, the moaning, the groaning, all the things that went along with these men being beaten and everybody being put in jail in these bad conditions. Let alone the fussing and the hollering when people were drug into prison and placed into a cell. What would they be used to hearing? But here Paul and Silas show up, beaten, bloody, and the last thing you would expect would be that they're praying and singing hymns. It says there in verse 25, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to him. And so Paul and Silas, again, singing, praying, and everybody's listening. And here's the point. I'm not sure that we understand as a congregation the tremendous evangelistic potential of a worshiping church. It really is the longing of my heart that God would move upon the people who were genuinely his own, and then by praying and singing his praises to God, people that are still prisoners to God, who may be visiting with us, who may be members, or who may be people who attend our church but are not Christians yet, people who are still prisoners of the enemy, would hear us when we sing and when we praise and when we give thanks to God. They would hear us, and because they don't understand what's going on, they have to have some kind of an explanation. What are you so happy about? Didn't you hear the news this morning? What are you so excited about? It's rainy and dreary outside. What are you so happy about this morning? Do you see what eggs cost this week? They don't know why we're acting the way we act when we truly come to worship. When we're truly here to worship a God. Listen, when you're here to worship, not watch a show. Our band's worth the cost of admission. Our choir is worth the cost of admission. But if you think about that a minute, it doesn't cost you anything to come in. So we're not really here to get caught up in the show. I want you to pay attention to me. I want you to hear what God has given me to give to you, but I'm not here to put on a show. I'm here to teach you, to preach to you, to tell you, and some people say from sometimes, boy, you lay it right out there, how else am I supposed to do it? I've been preaching for 25 years, and I try to lay it right out there, and people don't get it. How are they going to get it if you put candy coat on it? So here we are. They've gathered here, and when we gather here to worship, when we're praying, when we're singing, the lost world doesn't know what we're talking about, but that's good. But as we come, and I heard it in a prayer this morning, and when I heard it in that prayer this morning, it just, my soul got excited, because it was one of the points I was going to make. As a church, as the body of Christ, when we come into this place to worship, every time we show up in this place to worship, here's what we should have on our mind. What's God going to do today? It's just not coming in here and setting down. It's you're already, when you're getting dressed at home, when you're finishing up the makeup or the hair, or you're putting your shoes on, whatever you do, when you're getting ready to come to church on whatever we meet, when you're coming, you're thinking to yourself, what is God going to do today when I get to church? I'm gonna begin to worship him, and God is going to do something. God is just going to step out. He's going to show up, and he's going to show out. He's going to be there. Is that what we think when we come to church on a Sunday morning? I tend to think it may be a little bit differently. By the time we get the kids all packed into the car, it's like, whew. And then by the time you ladies tell your husbands to come on, and then by the time your husbands might tell your wife, come on, it starts at 10:30, you know, you look fine, come on. And it's the hassle sometimes of just getting here. and you're here and you do your job or you teach or you show up for Sunday school or you sing in the choir or whatever you do, and you forgot one thing this morning. Okay, I'm coming to this place, yes, to use my gifts, to use my talents, to use my abilities, but I'm coming to this place because God is going to show up. And when he shows up, there's going to be people around that church in the morning or that morning that may not know him. And so I want to make sure as I witness and as I worship that I'm coming into a place where I'm going to have this expectancy in my spirit that I'm going to meet with God today. My spirit's telling me, you're going to see God today. He's going to speak to you today. And I'm coming with this genuine desire in my life to encounter God. That's what I want. You see, when we come to worship, the me is passed, is left at the door. Just check that at the door. Check me at the door. It's not about you. It's not about me. When we come into this place, the musicians have prepared. Brother Blake's got everything laid out. I've prepared the best I know how to do. And whatever happens from there, it's just going to happen. But we want God to have control of that. We want to have an encounter with God so we can praise God. Now, I'm talking about worshiping here. I don't want you to be confused at all. Paul and Silas were singing. They were praying. No doubt, they were voiceful in what they were doing because the prisoners were listening to them. But listen, don't misunderstand me for one moment. You may express your worship in beautiful silence. And there's nothing wrong with a bowed head coming before God with raised hands raised up and looking towards heaven. There's nothing wrong with a quiet worship. Nothing wrong with that at all. But it can also be expressed by our singing. In many other ways, if you really think about it. But you'll know when you've experienced God in worship. I'm here just about every Sunday out of the year. I'll miss maybe four Sundays out of a year. I won't be here. But in those Sundays that I meet, when I walk out, there's some Sundays I walk out of this place and say, man, God was here. How could I explain it to you? I don't know. I just knew it. I just felt it. I just sensed it. I didn't see him visibly. You know, nothing got written on the walls. I just knew he was here. You're the same way. And it may not be the exact same Sunday that I said it. It may be another one. You see, but when the people of God come together and the Spirit of God stirs our heart, then we have this expression of God in our worship. And those that don't understand what's going on, when you begin to pray, when you begin to sing, when you begin to worship, when they don't understand what's going on, they have to listen. And they're looking at you. And then by God's grace, only by God's grace, will the Spirit of God start to move upon their hearts, and maybe, just maybe, they come to know Jesus just by watching you worship. He moves upon their lives so powerfully. And as a result of them being saved and coming a part of the congregation, all of a sudden this process starts taking over again and again and again, because this person who has just been saved, they now come into the church and they begin to worship. And then people come into the church and say, what's going on in this place? Why do you people sing like you sing? Why do you pray like you pray? Why do you do the things like you do? And your answer is simply because Jesus is Savior. Because he is my Lord. Well, they might reply, I never knew that. And you could say, well, let me tell you about that. Let me tell you about him. Can I do that? Yes, tell me. And all of a sudden, they join the church. They become a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ because of your witness. And it may all start with your worship. Let us be a church that worships and witnesses together. Paul and Silas, you think about Paul and Silas, they've been beaten with rods. They could have done a number of things once they got settled in the jail cell. They could have done a number of things. They might have said, Paul said to Silas, our rights have been infringed upon. We need to get some parchment. And let's get some parchment, my friend, and let's write down how terribly we've been treated as citizens. How we've been mistreated by the officials, how the jailer has mistreated us. This is a violation of our civil rights. We shouldn't be in this place. Let's tell somebody about that. Or they could have just sat there in silence, you know, doubting that God was even with them anymore. Why would God allow this to happen? All we were doing was his will. We delivered a slave girl from a demon. That's one of those good days. And now all of a sudden we're in prison. We're being beaten. And now we're locked up. God must not be with us anymore. And again, they could have talked about just the cruel way that they had been treated. But you see their reaction to their circumstance totally different. And that's what's a challenge to me, at least. It says, at midnight, they were praying and singing. This phrase here is actually in the imperfect tense, which means they didn't sing the doxology and go to sleep. It says here they were praying and singing. It meant they were continually singing and praying. They started about midnight, and they went until the earthquake occurred. I don't know how long that was, but they just started singing and praying and praising God. They didn't worry about what time it was. We talk about worship. One of the most powerful worship times that I've ever had in my life, believe it or not, was an overnight. It started at 7 o'clock, went till 6 o'clock the next morning, an overnight men's prayer meeting, and it was packed. I bet you we had 300 men there. Friday night, 7 o'clock, went till 6 o'clock Saturday morning. We ate breakfast at 6 and went home. I got to preach at 2 a.m. And it was a night of preaching, praying, testimony, singing all night long in segments, all night long. I've never seen a group of men worship like that in my life. I've been to big men's events, but it wasn't like that. I've never seen it, the breaking and the surrendering and the confession. I've never seen anything like that. But it was a night of worship. And at 6 o'clock when we ate breakfast and I went home, I was totally exhausted. Not so much from being up all night long, but just by everything that God had taken out of me that night. It was powerful. But that's what these men were doing. They were singing. They had been singing all night long. Why? Because they recognized when Paul and Silas was put in this cell, they recognized that God was with them in everything that they did, but he was also with them in their imprisonment. God was there. God had given them the ability to speak to Lydia, and they spoke. He was with them. God had given them the ability to see the exorcism of this slave girl, and he was with them. And God was with them as they tolerated the pain of being beaten with rods. God was with them. In the same way God was with them in all of those circumstances, God is still with them in the middle of this jail cell, and they sing out in the night, and they praise God. It's like Paul and Silas said, well, we're here. We're bloody, we're beaten, we're sore, we're tired, we're shackled down. Why don't we just praise God? Let me ask you this. You're here this morning. Why don't you just praise God? You done made the effort to get here. Got showered, got dressed, got made up. Man, you're ready. Okay, you're here, so since you're here, you might as well put something into it and just go ahead and worship and praise God. That's what we've gathered for anyway. Make the effort. I say it again, I'm not sure that we understand the evangelistic potential of a worshiping congregation. It says here, and the prisoners were listening to them. Now let me preface something here. I don't expect lost people, when they walk into the church doors, I don't expect them to be singing. I really don't. I don't expect them to sing. I don't expect them to be the most vocal person in the congregation that's singing. If I was lost, I wouldn't sing either. I might think the tune's catchy, and I might hum it that afternoon sometime. I do that with some of the songs we sing on Sunday morning. I'll catch myself Sunday afternoon humming one of those songs that we sang. I might hum it later on, but it really wouldn't mean anything to me. I'm lost. I don't understand what crowns and robes and crosses mean. I don't understand what sin and redemption mean. I'm lost. I don't know. I don't know your language. Don't know what it means at all. So when I look out in the congregation, I see people just standing there. I see them just staring out blankly into space. Like now. I see them just staring out blankly into space. I think to myself, I should understand that. Brother Blake, you should understand that. Dead people don't sing. Those that aren't alive in Christ don't sing his praises. That should challenge us. You say, preacher, you just offended me. Good. Better me than the Lord. You know when you go to a basketball game or a football game, something, they have what they call the kiss cam. You ever seen that? You know, there'll be a guy and a girl. They don't know if they know each other or not, I don't guess. They just, a guy and a girl sitting there, and they'll put them up on the screens, you know. It'll be outlined, it'll say kiss cam. And so they expect one of them to reach over and kiss the other one, right? That's a kiss cam. What about next Sunday we have a worship cam? And we just have the camera going around on Sunday morning, and all of a sudden you look up and you're on the screen, and it says worship cam. What are you going to look like? What are you going to look like when the worship cam comes out next week? Be ready. I got a guy up there running our live stream. They'll be more than willing. Be ready. But if we pan through next Sunday and it said worship cam, what would your worship look like? Again, it's not for everybody else to see. You're worshiping God. He sees what you're doing. Would you be a great witness for Christ? As a church, let us worship, let us sing, but let us make more than notes and tunes and melodies. We're good at that. Our band's great. Our worship leader is marvelous. Our choir can sing. We can do all of that stuff really, really well. But worship and witness doesn't have to do with notes and melodies and beats. It has to do with the anointing of the Holy Spirit of God upon our lives. You may be the worst singer within 100 miles, but if God is leading you in worship, keep on singing. You may not be singing a special on Sunday morning, but you can sing a special right where you're at. God wants us to be worshiping people who have gathered here. And for those of us who are gathered here this morning who are serious about worshiping the Lord, focus on that. When we come together for worship, leave your stuff at the door. Don't worry about if there's kids running around. God bless kids. I wish we had 1,000 running around here on Sunday morning. Don't worry about that. If they're not your kids particularly, don't worry about that. You don't got to take them home. Just worship anyway, because your worship is between you and God. You should have already zeroed in on him before you came, expected to see him. Remember, he's going to be here. And while you're worshiping God, you're a witness for God, because somebody just might be watching you. Say, why does she do that? Why does he do that? What's it mean? I mean, you take the lady that's in Mark's gospel who comes with an alabaster jar of ointment to see Jesus. I mean, that's an amazing story to me. I mean, she takes this expensive jar of perfume and she cracks it, she breaks it, and she pours it out. And the people saw her coming with this and they said, you're crazy. You're crazy. Don't you know how much that's worth? Don't you know what you could have done with that? Of course she understood all that. She knew what it was worth. She knows what she could do. This lady had that in her dowry. That expensive perfume was meant for two things. One of two. It was to be used on her wedding night when she became a bride, a wife. It was to be used on that night, or it was to be used for her burial. One or the other. is an anointing for her burial. So do you think that she simply went home that day and said, let me find some old something that I can carry along with me just because I might run into Jesus today? I don't think she did that. I don't think she went over and said, well, I've got some Bed Bath and Beyond somewhere over here, or I got some kind of other concoction. I can just grab any old something, and I can carry that with me, and I can anoint Jesus with just whatever I got. I'll give him whatever I got. Sound like a church member that you might know? I'll give him whatever I got. No. She went into her dowry and she said, I'll take this and I'll break this. And as a result of her taking and breaking it, there was a transformation in this woman's life. God powerfully moved in her worship. And one of the reasons I think that we sometimes see our worship so ineffective is because there's no purposeful taking and there's no meaningful breaking when we come to church. We don't purposely come expecting to see Jesus and then just breaking our heart and our soul open and pouring it out before him when we come. And so worship is not what it needs to be. And again, I'm not talking about worship style. It can be any old worship style. It doesn't matter what the style of worship is. I'm not talking about it being lively. I'm not talking about worship being silent. I'm not talking about it that way at all. I don't even know what worship is supposed to look like. But I do know when you experience it, you'll know it. I do know when you will experience it, you will know it. I've worshiped in a church that sang hymn book 104, 107, 103, all five verses. I've worshiped in the one that does more contemporary music with some hymns mixed in. I've worshiped that way. I've worshiped in a church that just did rock band type music. But I could worship there because it's not about me. Every time I come to worship, regardless of what we're singing, it's about God. We forget that. We want our itch scratched. That's what we want. But God is a church saying, you're my body. I want you to come serve me and worship me. That's what he's expecting from us. We'll know when we've experienced that worship. It has to do with the intangible things, the things that we just can't see. Paul and Silas were worshiping, and they had this great encounter with God, and we can have that same encounter with God in our lives. But I want you to realize a couple things. I'm getting ready to close up here. Genuine Christian praise and worship is theological. It's biblically based. I mean, I'm reading straight from Scripture from you this morning, but in other words, it's grounded in the truth of God. If we're going to worship and we're going to praise God, it's grounded in his truth. Paul and Silas recognized that God was in control in every step of their life. They understood that. From Lydia to the slave girl to the prison cell, they knew that God was in control. They knew that God was there, and therefore their focus was going to remain the same. Regardless of what was going on in their life, regardless of what was happening in their life, their focus on worship was going to remain the same. And church, that's what we're told to do. We're told that God is worthy of our praise. And if God is worthy of our praise, what this means is all true understanding begins with the truth that God alone is worthy of our worship. He is the only one. We're not worshiping anything else. We're just worshiping God for what he's done. You see, because we can't understand ourselves as created people until we understand God, our creator. People have questions about themselves all the time. Get to know God first, and then you can get to know yourself. We can't understand the evil until we understand the good which it opposes. So when the church declares that God is worthy, we're declaring that God's truth defines my life, it defines every goal that I have in my life, it defines everything that I want to do with my life. It's all based on his truth. He's worthy of my praise. When you come in on Sunday morning to worship, he's worthy of every ounce of worship that you can give him. Creation calls us to praise. One of the ways we know God is worthy of our praise is through the testimony of creation. The Bible says creation calls for us to praise. Creation calls for us to praise. God may be a spirit. He may be invisible to our physical eyes, but the Bible tells us we can clearly perceive what his invisible attributes look like. When you know God, you know God. You know what he looks like. You know what he sounds like. You don't have any questions. I hear people all the time, and they say this, and it's as a Christian, we need to really think about what we just got through saying, because people say, well, I don't know if it's God or not. What? You don't know if it's God or not? I've used this illustration before, but when I get a telephone call and the person on the other end is a female, and she says, hi, sweetie, how are you doing? I better know it's my wife. I don't got to see her, but I know her voice. I know it's her. I didn't hang up the phone and say, well, I'm doing fine, honey. How are you doing? And hang up and say, who in the world was that? No, I knew who she was. So if you're walking close with God, if you're worshiping God, you're praising God, and you have to ask the question, was that God? You shouldn't have to ask that question. You should know. We should be praising him. The Apostle Paul says in Romans 1:20, it tells us that God's eternal power and divine nature are clearly evident to people in the things that have been made. God's nature is evident. God is clearly there for those people that see him, especially his people. We should see him. Jesus' sacrifice calls us to praise. Keep that truth in mind just a minute. In our churches, in our worship services, we contain many activities. We have songs and hymns and prayers and statement of faith and testimonies. All these activities are grounded in the finished work of Jesus. When we sing about what Christ has done on the cross, when we talk about what Christ has done in our work, in our lives, we're remembering what Jesus has done. His testimony causes us to want to praise instead of drawing encouragement from our own praise. We need to be drawing that encouragement from our praise, but we need to be turning it into song. We need to be lifting our voices. We need to be fervent in our singing. When we gather together, we are singing about what God has done. Hebrews 10:14 says, by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. That's a purely theological statement, that God is sanctifying his people. And our songs, as we pray, reflect our confidence, reflect our trust. Paul and Silas didn't base their theology on their circumstances. Instead of they evaluated their circumstances in the light of what they knew about God. That's how we should evaluate our lives and our circumstances, the good times, the bad times. We should evaluate that based on what we know about God. And then their songs express this confident trust in God. They didn't have to wait long, though. They began to sing, and they didn't have to wait long before God showed up. I mean, their witness and their worship changes everything here. Instead of complaining, they began to worship. And all of a sudden, as they're worshiping, it says this earthquake took place. The prison cell was shaken. The walls were torn down, and everyone's chains were unfastened. Everybody was free to go and do whatever they wanted to do. The earthquake roused the jailer from his sleep, and seeing the prison doors were open and the bars were gone, and he drew his sword, and the reason he drew his sword was because he knew that he was going to face death for letting the prisoners escape. He was just going to kill himself, get it over with. No use worrying about it, thinking about it very long. Just go ahead and end my life. But the Bible says before he could do that, Paul cried out in this loud voice, telling him, don't harm yourself. We're all here. We haven't gone anywhere. In fact, we were just about to get started on the third verse. We're not going anywhere. We're not moving. Not only Paul and Silas, but all the other prisoners were still there. I think they liked what they were hearing. Astonished by this unbelievable turn of events, the jailer calls for the lights, and they rush in, And with fear and trembling, the Bible said he falls on his knees before Paul and Silas. Something just tells me here God was there, because he was aware of the message. Paul and Silas had preached. The earthquake happened, something supernatural. This is a confirmation in the jailer's mind that they spoke the truth. And it says here in verses 30 through 34, then he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" All he was doing was watching. "Sirs, what do I have to do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you and your household." And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and all who were in his house. And he took them that same hour of the night, and he washed their wounds, and he was baptized at once, he and his family. Then he brought them into his house and set food before them, and he rejoiced along with them and with the entire household that he had believed in God. The jailer's just listening to the sermons. He's just listening to the prayers. He's just listening to the songs. God shows up in a powerful way, and all the jailer can say to the people is, "Your witness has changed my life. The way you worship has changed my life. What must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved?" You see, leading somebody to Christ, folks, starts with the way we act. Are you worshipful in church? When they look at you, do they say to themselves, "I would like to have that spirit. I would love to have that spirit. I want that confidence. I want to know that I'm saved. I want to know my salvation is secure. I want to know there is a place for me in God's heaven. I want to know that." If that person knows it, I can tell by looking at them. I can see that she knows him. I can see that he knows him. I want to know that. But their worship and their witness in that jail cell that night made a difference. And the lesson for the church is to praise even when you don't feel like it. Think about that a minute. Do you think Paul and Silas felt like singing and praying? I don't know about you. I'm just trying to put myself in their sandals for a minute. I've just been beaten with rods. Dreadfully is what the scripture says. I've been terribly beaten. I can imagine the pain. I can imagine the exhaustion of having that done to you. But instead of trying to rest, sleep, they decide they're going to have church. I don't believe they felt like it. Their backs were open. They were in this prison cell in stocks. I don't think they looked at one another and said, Silas said, "Paul, how do you feel?" Paul said, "Well, it's about the worst I've ever felt in my life." And Silas said, "Well, Paul, let's just go ahead and praise God anyway. I know you feel bad, but let's just go ahead and sing a few songs. Let's just pray a little bit." Paul said, "Well, I guess so." Silas said, "Well, didn't you write to churches telling them to be thankful in all circumstances?" Paul said, "Yeah, I did that." Didn't you tell them, doesn't matter what you feel like or what's going through or what's happening in your life, that you're still supposed to be worshiping God?" And he says, "Yeah, I told them that." So they just launched into their singing, which led to the jailer being saved. The idea of us coming together on a Sunday morning to worship is something that we just don't understand how God works in many cases. But it's one of those things when we come, we may not feel like it. We're here, and you're saying, "God, give us a point for showing up." But God says, "You're here, why don't you just go ahead and worship?" Because you don't realize how it's going to change your circumstances to begin with, but you don't realize how it may change somebody else's circumstance. How it may. I was at a funeral years ago. A friend of mine was a beautiful singer, and he was a part of that all-night men's prayer meeting I was telling you about. I mean, he could sing. I assume he still can. But he and his wife had a baby. And birth went fine. Mom and baby and daddy got home. Within 4 or 5 days, the baby died unexpectedly. And I'll never forget calling him just to check on see how he was doing. This was before I was a pastor. I was just a guy in the church, you know. And I called him and I said, "Hey, I heard what happened. How are you?" He goes, God's got this. God's in control here." He said, "God is my Savior. He gave us that child, and he decided he wanted him back." I believe God. Man, he was just preaching to me on the phone, you know. He gave me the rundown on the funeral, and he said, "It's going to be a worship service. Don't come crying. Don't come gloomy. It's going to be a worship service. We're going to praise God." I got to church that day, and I sat back. They come up and said a few words, and it's just vivid in my mind, a coughing about so long, just right up front. Church is packed with people. And it was singing, and it was praying. But right before the pastor got up to preach the message that day, Patrick, the father, came forward, and he sang, "It is well with my soul." We had worship that day. His little baby was in heaven with the Lord, no doubt in my mind. But we had church that day in a place you never expect to have church, in a funeral service. But folks, that's how it should be for us. And this isn't a funeral service. When we come into the doors on Sunday morning, we should be singing our praise. It should be natural for us to come in and praise and worship God and tell others about how we love him and how he loves us and what he has done for us and how he has saved us and how he has been with us and how he has looked over us and how he has protected us and on and on and on and on. And our simple task in life is to just let him be known to other people. And the easiest way to do that is just by your worship on Sunday morning. When everybody sees how much you truly love God. This morning, are you a believer in Christ? Do you believe that Jesus died for you on the cross, that he died for your sins? If there'd been nobody else in the entire world, he died for you on the cross. The Bible tells us plainly that's what happened. But if you believe that, have you ever received him as your Lord and Savior? Have you repented of your sin and received Christ as your Savior? If not, today should be that day. You begin to worship him today for what he has done for you, not for anybody else, for you. Secondly, if you're a believer, if you've given your life to Christ and you're not a member of a local church, this all started out, this whole series, I am the church. We are the body of Christ. This morning, why not join with this church? Take your place in the body to serve him and to let him be known to other people. Maybe you're saved this morning, you haven't been baptized yet. You need to follow the Lord in scriptural baptism. Your first act of obedience is baptism. Maybe you need to do that. This morning, I pray as a church that our goal would be that our worship of our Lord would increase, our witness for our Lord would increase, and by increasing, we would see other people come to know him. Let's pray this morning. Father, out of these words, I pray that you might hear my voice, but more importantly, that I would hear your voice. That we might hear what your Spirit says to the churches. That you would stir us up, that we would think along these lines of making our worshiping and our witnessing in this community of believers a place that we come to praise you. And so, Father, we pray that you would encourage us, that you would lift us up, that we would know you and make you known. This morning, I pray for any decision that needs to take place. And we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
I hear the Savior say,
Pensacola. Also, it's time to eat fish, I guess. We're going to go to the Fellowship Hall. If you're visiting with us, it's down this hallway, or you can go out the front and go down to the next building and come in the front door. It should be waiting, so I'm going to pray that prayer for this meal today. So when we get under, you can just start eating. And I pray this week we would go out thinking about how we can be a witness for Christ, and also praying about our outreach next Sunday or next Saturday for our block party. Be praying for that. I've encouraged you for a couple weeks now, pray for good weather and a good turnout. And right now, the weather looks like more of a problem than the turnout, but I think the long-term forecast looks a little damp. But we're going to pray for good weather. We're going to pray for a good turnout. So y'all do that this week, all right? All right. I was making sure she didn't need me. We're going to pray, okay? We're going to pray together. Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for this church and for this gathering that we've had today. You bless us now. We pray for Jack. And Lord, I pray for his health, and I pray that him and Debbie would make it home safely. And Lord, they'd be able to get Jack up and going again. I pray you just bless that young man right now. Lord, I pray for our meal that we're about to have in a few moments. Lord, bless the food for all those who have brought items to go with it. We thank you for Adam and all the men who have been frying fish this morning. So, Father, we thank you for them. So, Father, you bless our fellowship time this afternoon, and we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Thanks for joining us this morning for worship at First Baptist Church Cantonment. We were so glad that you were with us this morning. I pray that you are blessed by the singing of songs to our Lord, but also by the opening of his word together and allowing God to speak into our lives. This morning, I pray that you receive a great blessing by that. Look forward to seeing you next time that we're together. Join us anytime at First Baptist Church Cantonment here in Cantonment, Florida. We'd be glad to see you. Look us up on our Facebook page. Check out our website and come visit with us. Again, have a great week.